Hello friends, Amy R. here with Prairie Paper and Ink, with a couple more backgrounds that I had made in my previous video. So if you didn't watch that video, I showed how I made a bunch of backgrounds using these Distress Oxide sprays and some Ranger Heavy Stock paper. And I'll link to the colors I used, etc. And then I'll also have a link to that previous video. So I grabbed a couple more of them because I'd made multiples and I'd only used two of them in the last video. So I grabbed two more. And this time I'm applying a bit of Distress Microglaze over it. I don't use microglaze very often. I almost never seal my backgrounds that I create with oxides, sprays, etc., etc. I get asked that often if I do, I don't. I don't seal them. I don't really worry about it too much. But I'm just experimenting here. The nice thing with the microglaze is it does, if you apply enough of it, it will basically seal your backgrounds. You can also use like a spray sealant, like a matte spray sealant, etc. Same thing. I haven't like bothered. But one of the nice things when you do use it over something like this that has been created with a Distress Oxide spray is it will somewhat take away a bit of that chalky texture you can get sometimes and make the colors kind of shine through a bit more. You especially see this if you do like the smooshing technique or sprays on a glossy cardstock. I've done videos on that in the past where everything looks kind of muddy and chalky, but then you apply the microglaze and like the colors just pop. It's really fun. I haven't done that in a while. I'll have to do it. But I was just experimenting. I kind of wanted to make the colors pop a bit more. I didn't apply very much. I just pick up the microglaze with one of my little blending foams and I was kind of mushing it onto just a, you know, non-stick craft sheet and then just rubbing it onto the backgrounds. And you could see there, compared to a couple other backgrounds I did, you know, it does make them a bit more vibrant. So off camera, I did use my heat tool as well. You can, after you apply microglaze, you can use your heat tool and it kind of melts it into the cardstock even more. And then you can stamp on top of it, do all those things. If you look up, I'm sure there's tons of other tutorials. Like I said, I haven't used it very much. So I'm just experimenting. So I use my heat tool again because I'm trying to make sure that these are not going to cling to a bunch of embossing powder because I want to stamp and heat emboss. So I'm just testing this out beforehand. I've just sped this up and I was using my, like heavily using my anti-static powder tool and just kept pouring embossing powder over it to make sure that it's not going to just stick to everything because I only want the embossing powder to stick to the stamped image. So once I was happy with that, I've got my background and my Misty. I used one of my Misty Creative Corners just to push the background up a bit because I'm using this great big stamp. This is the Simon Says Stamp Wildflower stamp that I have done many videos on. I have a playlist with those videos. It will be linked at the end of this video because I've used this a lot. It's one of my faves again. There's a new one as well that I will link to because I think honestly the stamps that sold out at the moment. Because I didn't check before I posted this video. But there's a new one by CZ Design that's like a smaller version. And I think it's really cute. I could have used that instead. But this, So I'll link to it though, because that is another option. And I will be using that one in a future video. So just stay tuned. So anywho, I stamped the image with clear embossing ink. Coated it with Detail White embossing powder. And then melted it with my heat tool. So then I've got this just, again, this like summery, sunset-y sort of background and that stamp. And since this set has two stamps, I'm going to repeat the process with the other stamp using the background in my Misty, bumped it up with that little L-shaped creative corner, heavily used my anti-static powder tool. I just have mine in just a random little like this, that ceramic container. People have asked over the years where I got that. It was part of like a chip and dip set in my kitchen like a lifetime ago. Got rid of a lot of it because I don't entertain, but the little like dishes, those little tiny ceramic bowls, this one is perfect for holding my embossing powder bag. And then I have a little binder clip holding it because I don't like the feel of that, like the anti-static powder. It annoys me. So that hopefully explains a lot. So anywho, did the same process on the second panel. I somewhat brushed away any, you know, random excess powder that was still clinging to the background here and there. I'm not too worried about it because with like this busy of a background and I'm of course going to add more splatter, I'm not worried about, you know, stray bits of embossing powder. So they're both melted. They're good to go. put them in my splat box. And then my go-to splatter, which is a mixture of Perfect Pearl powder and white gouache that I just keep in the ceramic palette and I just keep reactivating with water. And then I keep adding more, you know, the next time I go. So pick that up with a brush, splatter it on these backgrounds. And then I just put some water on my little nonstick mat here. And so there's still like pigment, there's still shimmer in the, like what was in the brush, just heavily watered down. So I splattered that all over the backgrounds as well, because why not? Splatter is life. So I let those dry. And then my main sentiment is the new magical wafer die from Simon Says Stamp. And I had die cut that multiple times from heavyweight white cardstock. And then I die cut some gold glitter cardstock. I was like, this time, let's pull out the gold. Like, why not? So I did two layers of the white cardstock and I just stacked that together with craft tacky glue. And then the top layer is going to be this gold glitter cardstock. And then the outline I die cut from vellum. So once I've got my words stacked together, I'm going to apply the adhesive to the back of them and adhere it to the vellum outline. And just like I do with all of when, you know, stacking my wafer dies, I pretty much always use craft tacky glue, but I just use little dots, thin little lines, little dots, not tons of glue because you don't want it oozing out everywhere. But especially when adhering to vellum and then when I adhere these to the cards, I keep a very light amount of glue because, and you don't need much, honestly, when you're gluing just paper to paper, you don't need very much glue. So I adhered those together. And then off camera, I had white heat embossed sentiments from the coordinating Magical to Me stamp set. So I'd white heat emboss them and then just trim them down with my paper trimmer. Speaking of my paper trimmer, I'm also going to trim down these backgrounds. Right now they were A2 size, so 4.25 by 5.5. So I'm going to trim them down to about 4 by 5.25. So just slightly smaller than what my card base will be. So after I trim those down, I'm going to adhere these sentiments, like I said, little light dots of glue, not a whole lot, directly behind the actual words so that it doesn't come out past, like, past the word onto the vellum where you can see it, because you can see adhesive through vellum. Even the ones that claim that they're, like, they work with vellum, like vellum adhesives, I can still see them. It just depends on what I'm doing. Sometimes I don't care. I'm actually going to use liquid adhesive on vellum a little later on in this video. And in the end, you can kind of see it, and I don't care, but I'll explain why. So anywho, adhered my sentiments, and then the little sentiment strips, I just used my little Doris foam strips, pop those onto the back of them so that these cards say, "You are so magical to me." So lined those up, and as always, my messy hair is getting in the way, but whatever. So did that to both card fronts, and then I had some gold vellum in my stash. Regular vellum would work as well. In fact, regular vellum would probably stand out a little bit more, or shimmery vellum, anything like that. But as I was flipping through my vellum, I was like, ooh, I forgot I had this. So I die cut that with the Simon's like fluttering butterflies wafer die. I've used this wafer die so many times. I love it. So to adhere these, I just add the teeniest little dot of glue, and then I just press kind of the center of the butterfly into it. And this is what I was talking about. In the end, you can see those little dots of glue like through the vellum. I don't care. Like, it's such a small, tiny amount, it's not really that noticeable. If it bothers you, you could adhere, like, a little gemstone over it, you know, that sort of a thing. But with ones like this that are so small, I've never bothered. Like, that tiny, tiny little bit of glue that you see, meh. With larger butterflies or, like, dragonflies, those sorts of things, I keep, the, you know, the adhesive behind the body, and then I adhere, you know, a little cardstock body. With these, tiny, that's all you need, just the teensiest little dot of glue. And I only do it to the center because I want the wings, you know, popped up. It gives that little bit of dimension. So I did all that, set those aside, and now I'm going to work on the inside of my cards. And this I've shown in many videos as well, especially with this set. These types of images are perfect for this, but I have shown this many times. And I'm just using, I have the inside of my card lined up on my Misty. I use my Creative Corners. And then I have one of the Wildflower stamps. Got that lined up. And I'm going to ink this up with 3 different colors of oxide inks. It doesn't matter if you're doing a blend like this or you're just using one color. When inking up any sort of solid image, sometimes oxide inks work great. Sometimes they're a little more finicky. They're not specifically formulated for stamping. Just is what it is. But one way that really works is using your blending tool. People have been also using their blending brushes. That seems to work. Whatever floats your boat. My blending tools, like with my foams, are very saturated in ink, and you need them to be saturated to make this work. With this first one, I'm just inking up the stamp with the blending tools. Like, I'm not pressing the ink pad to the stamp. So I started with mustard, seed, oxide, and then I went to abandoned coral and then to festive berries. And I'm going to stamp that right onto the inside of the card. And I've got this gorgeous, like, gradient of color. That's, again, this is what, I love this stamp set. So the second one, I'm going to do the same thing, but I'm going to start by inking up the stamps with the actual ink pad. Again, I've shown this in previous videos, but like I said, with the oxides, and just if you're having, you know, if certain inks are kind of beating up and all that, like, this stamp is well loved. Like, this set, you can tell, like, these stamps are stained. Like, I have used just the crap out of them. So they take ink really, really well. But even then, sometimes inks just want to be finicky. So this is where, like, I inked it up the top portion with the ink pad. But then I took my blending tool that has all that mustard seed ink in it, and just I'm tapping it onto the stamp, and it just kind of smooths it out a bit. And then I'm just using the edge, like, I'm holding it on an angle of that abandoned coral ink pad and inking it out. And you can see those, like, stripes from the edge of the ink pad. That's not very pretty. But I blend that out and smooth it out with my ink tool. This doesn't take very long. You just tap, 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 and it just blends. And it also creates that nice blend between the colors as well. And that ink, abandoned coral foam, you could see, like, had picked up a lot of the yellow. So I just rub it off on the scrap paper that I'm working on, and I'm good to go. So then I went to the festive berries. This one, I got a little bit more of a solid image because there's more ink on the stamp. But either one works. You can ink it up with just the blending tool, or do the ink pads and the blending tool. Huge difference. And I just, again, these could be card fronts. Maybe I should actually make a video of doing a gradient stamping with this set and add it to my little series. I keep saying that so often to you guys. It's like, oh, the inside of this card could be a card front. But, and then I never do actually do that. But ideas. So anywho, I took my remaining little die cut butterflies, and I just adhered them to the inside of the card, because why not? So it's got some little gold butterflies on the inside. Didn't bother stamping any more sentiments or anything. Ones like this also, FYI, I do write right over it, because you can still see, you know, the pretty gradient background, everything on the inside of the card, but I have no problem writing over it with a pen when it's time to send it to someone. It doesn't bother me at all. So, insides are done. The card fronts I'm going to adhere with just foam tape. I did make sure to match up each stamp on the outside with the one on the inside, just so matchy-matchy, although really in the end it wouldn't. It's not the end of the world if I did mix it up, but I was paying attention for once. And then as a final bit of embellishment, because I could not resist, is some Studio Caudia gold crystal sequins. So these are the clear ones with the gold glitter in them that have just been a favorite of mine since they were released, whenever it was, like a couple years ago. And I still reach for these all the time. So, of course, I had to add a few of these to these cards as well, just to kind of tie in the golds, because I've got the gold sentiment, the little gold butterflies, the gold crystals, and then I'm actually going to pair these with some gold envelopes too, because I like gold. So, yeah. So I adhered the crystals into place, just little dabs, again, of the craft tacky glue, and then just using my little embellishment wand. And that's going to finish off these cards. So this is another way to use those inky backgrounds. Like I said, I will link to the previous video where I showed how I made them, and that'll be linked at the end of the video. I'll link also to the playlist using this wildflower stamp set. And yeah, did these cards, paired them with the gold envelopes, little gold butterflies, all sorts of fun things. As always, I will also link in the description box below the video. I'll link to my blog post. I'll have picture links in my blog post. I'll link to all the supplies I use, so you can check that out in the description box below if you are interested. Thank you all so much for watching, for subscribing, thumbs upping, commenting, all of it. I very much appreciate your support, and I will see you all very soon in the next video. Bye!